We welcome the community, Talmidim of Rav Center Zatzal, along with our current students, to the first Yahrzeit commemoration of Moreno Rabbeinu of Yitzchak Isaac Center Zatzal. The Chag of Chanukah was established as a yontif only after 1 year. Shana Acheres Kavum Ba'asum Yamim Tavu Ba'al Ba'hoda. Mufarshim explained that Chazal waited a year to see if the Nes and its message was fully appreciated and internalized. So 1 year later, we here in Chicago, in the Beis HaMedrash LaTorah, realize and appreciate who we had and the positive impact that Rav Sender Zatzal had on our city and our yeshiva. To commemorate his first Yahrzeit, we have today three speakers to give us a glimpse and a taste of Rav Sender's Torah and what made him so special, then followed by Mincha. First we have with us Rav Meir Sender, Rabbi Sender's son, the Rosh Yeshiva of Yeshiva's Das Chochma in Muncie, who flew in today to share with us Divrei Torah of his father on the Indian of Kiddush HaChodesh, and to share Divrei Zikaron. Would also acknowledge the presence of Rav Mordechai Sender, another son of Rav Sender Zatzal. So Rav Meir, please come up and share with us Divrei Torah and Divrei Zikaron.
It is an honor to address you in this Beis Medrash. What Beis Medrash LaTorah means to me is not confined to this building, a Carpenter Road. Rather represents a legacy, a Messiah of Torah and Yira, emanating from Douglas Boulevard, passed on to the present. In front of me, I see the G'dayli Rabbanim, Rosh Yeshivas, Nissi Yablonsky, Rav Korb, the Kaplan brothers, and all the G'dayli Rosh Yeshivas and Rabbanim that presided the Beis Medrash LaTorah. It is an honor to be Dairish in front of the Rosh Yeshiva Shlita, the Anhala Shlita, who together with my father taught here, Galant, and Gishdikin and Debbie's Medrash. It is an honor also just for me to be in this building, the building of my youth. Many a Shabbos, many a Simchas Torah, and Yeshiva Takayetz I spent here. I will be honest, the first thing I did when I came was to explore the tunnels to see if they're still there, the tunnels of my youth. And it is an honor to greet you, Chosh Rabbonim, the Talmidim, friends, and the greater Chicago community. Thank you for the honor. This week's Parsha is Parsha's Rosh Chodesh. And how apropos it would be if I would be able to say a shtickle Torah from my father's sefer, which was just reprinted on Kiddush HaChodesh. Sefer Tzvaras L'Moshe, reprinted by my nephew through the generosity of Bella Diebenstein, of David Schnell. I'd like to say one small vort from the sefer, maybe throw in a little bit of art on myself. There are three parts to the mitzvahs HaKadosh HaKadosh. The first part is called Shnas Halavonim. The second part is called La'abir Hashanah. And the third part is Ladas Tkufos Umazolos. The first din is that we're mechuyev to establish and to follow the lunar calendar, the lunar cycle. Say, there are two calendars that are dominant in the world. The Christians follow the solar calendar. the Arabs follow the lunar calendar. The Torah says, Kipshutai, we're mechuyev to follow Rosh Chodeshim, to follow the lunar calendar, the lunar cycle. That is the first din. The Tzveita din, called La'abir Hashanah. La'abir Hashanah is the Torah foresaw ki'ilu a problem. Since there is an 11-day discrepancy between the solar calendar and the lunar calendar. It means there are 665 days in a solar year, there are 354 days in a lunar year. And the Torah says, Shemur is chodesh aviv asisa pesach Hashem alekecha, is that there's a din that yom and tovim have to fall on in the right time. La'avdil, the Arabs have this problem, they have their chag called Ramadan. And if you don't know really what's going on, you'll never understand where Ramadan is. Because one year it could be in September, and the next time they're making trouble, 6 months later it's in March. Because they have this problem, the lunar calendar has to coincide with the solar calendar. The Torah says, Shemor is chodesh aviv v'nachadin, to bridge the gap, to be mishabed, and to subject the lunar calendar to the solar calendar. That's the din of Yom Hashanah. And the third din is the din of Tekuvos and Mazalos. We'll put that aside for now. Svanana and Machlek, Svishin, the Rambam and the Ramban, on this second din of Yom Hashanah, the Rambam says that in Kiddush HaChodesh, Halacha Aleph and Halacha Beis, and Sefer Mitzvah, Simen Kuf Nun Gimel, the Rambam says it's one big mitzvah. It's the mitzvah of Rosh Chodesh, and that incorporated in that mitzvah is the mitzvah that if there's a problem every 3 years come out, like this year, you have to be Ma'abed Hashanah. The Ramban brings the Bahag and Simen Kufnum Gimel, Mitzvah Kufnum Gimel, Mitzvah Shechus Ramban. And the Ramban says that no, those are two different mitzvahs. It's the aim mitzvah to be Ma'abed, to keep the follow of the lunar calendar. And there's a second mitzvah of Yibra Hashanah, to make sure they coincide, to make sure that the lunar calendar is some sort subject to the solar calendar. In one of my footnotes, my father asked, what's the machlekes rishonim? So Zdagra, Babusta Biskarab, and this union of Kiddush HaChodesh, of their machlekes, the Rambam in Rashi, a different machlekes. Another Gemara. The Gemara says, let's say we have another reason why Beis Din should have to change the calendar. Let's say the roads weren't ready, and therefore Pesach, we need all the Eilei Golim to have proper roads. So the Gemara handles if we could go and be Ma'abed Hashanah for such a rule. A lot of handlerai in the Gemara. Says the Brisker Rav, there's a Machlekes Rashi and the Rambam, how that would work. According to Rashi, the way that would work is simple. Since Rashi holds, there are two different mitzvahs, the way we'll say it. So there's a mitzvah to be Mekadosh Levana, there's a mitzvah of keeping and establishing the lunar calendar. There's another mitzvah to be Ma'abed Hashanah, to fix, to make sure Yom Tov comes at the right time. Says the Bisgrav, according to Rashi, the same way Chazal are Meshubet to fix the year, the Yom Tov should come. So too, Beis Din is Meshubit to make sure the system, the collective society works. And therefore it's the same din, the Beis Din would be Ma'abed Hashanah for Yontif. So too, if they have to fix the roads, Beis Din would be Ma'abed Hashanah, it's the same din. The din of Chodesh Aviv is that Beis Din makes sure that the system works. As I learned, the Bisker of Rashi. Abramata diik in the Rambam, and it's a shver diik, but the Rambam says mafurish. He says the din of achodesh aviv, that the Rambam says, isn't the way the Brisker Rav says it, and isn't the way Rashi says it. Rather, it's a din that we have to create and develop a new shnois achama. And the lashon of the Rambam is as follows. The Rambam says, the din of Rosh Chodesh, HaChodesh HaLechem, is that the months go b'asa the lunar months. Aber the din of a chodesh ha'aviv isn't like Rashi that they have to coincide. Rather, it's a chiddush that we have to reevaluate and say that our years go basa de shnoi sachama. We have a paradox here. We have one din saying that you go basa de shnas levana, one din saying you go basa de shnas sachama. So, Rabbi, you know how you coincide? It's just the year, make a new year. The months follow the lunar cycle. The year goes also the solar cycle. And obviously, the Rambam has a different year than us. The Rambam has to make it 354, 354, and 384. Therefore, it stems. But the chiddush of the Rambam is that we have to change our perception. Like Rashi, the word is, it's a very simple lunar month year, similar to the Arabs, except we bridge the gap. And we make it subject to the solar month, solar year. Like the Rambam, we have a new type of year. The year is a solar year based on the lunar months. Obviously, to answer the first kasha, why the Rambam holds it's one mitzvah, and the Rashi holds it's two, it's shitasa. Rashi holds there are taka two mitzvahs. The first mitzvah is to make a lunar year. The second mitzvah is to bridge the gap. Like Rambam, or somebody else, the Rambam says the Torah, by saying Achodesh Zelachem, coupled with Shemoris Chodesh Aviv, is making a new type of year. The year is a year of Shnei Sachama that goes with the months of Shnei Slavona, a Naya type of year. And that's clear what the Machlokes is, as always. The Shaila is, why would the Rambam do that? What is wrong with something I think all of us know in kindergarten already, maybe a little bit older, that we follow the lunar year and it happens to be a problem. We don't want this Ramadan issue. So we bridge the gap. Why would the Rambam have to go and make a new year? You have to realize the Rambam has a crazy dinch. I didn't know till now. That we follow the summer year, we follow the sun. It happens to be that the months are a lunar month. Why would the Rambam feel that he has to change the whole idea of what a shana is, the whole idea? What's wrong with learning the way Rashi does? Am I being clear? Yeah. So I'd like to say one small part. One small part to understand what the Rambam did. L'chayr v'shtedin Rambam is a part back east. We would say the Rambam holds the chepza fun shana. And what that means is the Rambam has a problem with Rashi's understanding of how the years work. Because there's a kashan Rashi. When we do yontif, let's say Korban Pesach has to be Yud Daled Nisan. So what the Torah said is it has to be on Yud Daled Nisan. When we do a drabana, let's say a Yud Daled Eretz Yisrael, Yud Daled Kriyas Megillah. So it has to be Yud Daled Adar and Kriyas Megillah. In fact, the Rambam Akashan Rashi. That's really wonderful that we follow the Shnas Levana. That's really wonderful. And every day since we follow the Shnas Levana, so when we sit in the Sukkah on Tezvav, Tishrei, we're really sitting on the Sukkah at the proper time. And when we do, you sit there, you're Kippur on Yud Tishrei, that's the proper Yom. However, Berega, we have a problem that we have to bridge it with the solar year. And what we do is we make an artificial 30 days. In fact, the Rambam Akasha and Rashi, it's beautiful that you were able to bridge the gap. That's really wonderful. However, it's artificial. And it's going to come out that when this year Pesach, according to the Rambam, is not really Pesach. Terence, what do we have to do? We have to make an Iber Shon an artificial day, so we should have Pesach at its right time. But the Rambam Akasha, that doesn't make any sense, because it's not Pesach. And when we have Pesach, it has to be in Chal on the Etzem Yoyim. Has to be on that day. But the Rambam Rashi can't be. So what Rambam had to do was to develop a new type of year. involved, he developed a new type of ear, it comes out that even though we have Kibbushah, and even though we have an extra 30 days, those 30 days are correct. It might look a little bit convoluted. It might be that we have to fuse a Shnas Levana with a Shnas Chama. Oh, but at least we could say it's a proper day. It's the Etzem day of Yontif. And L'chari, that's why the Rambam made this new idea called a Shnas Hachama based on the months of the Levana. Again, it's a paradox in terms, but the Rambam had to do it, because if he wouldn't have done it, we wouldn't have a proper day. Do I have to receive a scum on this? So I like to give it a little bit of a Hesper, a little bit weiter. To realize that it's not only not a chiddush, it's a pashut pshat. And I want to say over a story that I heard from my Rebbe, Rabbi Shaul from Shlita, and something similar that I heard from my Reshiva, Meir Stern Shlita, about a common mistake, what we call a mitzvah. And with that, we'll give it a little bit of salt and pepper, we'll call it. The way we understand a mitzvah, mitzvah is the tzivu. You're commanded to do something. And there's 613 type of commandments. I knew a person who took this idea of tzivu, and he said, told his Talmidim, don't worry about what type of esrog you should get. As long as you do the commandment, the mitzvah is a tzivu. And the lulav and esrog are nothing more than a hechatimsa to do the tzivu. 613 ways to really to do tzivu Hashem. And avada nesapsha. Never think that way. A mitzvah doesn't mean a hechatimsa to do tzivu. And the proof is like this. It's all over Shas. But my Rebbe used to bring one proof from Taisa's Kedushin of Chavtesim and Aleph, where Taisa says that a woman who does a mitzvah is mekayim the same mitzvah as a man. It's called Eina Mitzvah Ba'isa. And Taisa says theoretically she would mitzvah the etza mitzvah. She would get the same scar as a man. It happens to be that since she doesn't have to do it, she has something called pas masala. She could get out of it. It's easier. But were we to look at the raw, unadulterated mitzvah, a woman would be the exact same thing. Like Rabbi Kasha. If tzivu means a commandment, she's not commanded. A katan would be the same thing. Her mayor once brought down the Shiva Shlita. Once brought down, you can have a katan, you can do the exact same mitzvah as me. Like the mayor, the katan is not mitzvah. The whole idea of a mitzvah is a Pesach. We always find famous Gemara. The Gemara says, if you eat Pesach, matzah, the whole 7 days, your yitz of mitzvah kiyumas, not kiyumas. Well, the whole word of a mitzvah is a mitzvah. There's no such thing as kiyumas of yuvas. It's all one mitzvah. The Rebbe used to say, there aren't 613 hechatimsas to do tzivu. In fact, the Shalosh says tzivu doesn't mean commandments. Tzivu means tafsa, it's loshen biyachad. There are 613 ideas that God created that through the idea you can have a tzavtza, a yachas with him. There's something what we call a heftz of a lulud and esrog. There's the heftz of an achilas matzah, and there's the heftz of a shabbos. That means you don't take a lulud as a hechatimsa to do kiyam adin. Ridiculous. Rather, there's a kiyam adin in the lulud. When a person takes a lulud and an esrog, with the lulav of an esrog, there's a kiyum. And when a person takes dozen achilas matzah, it's chal in the etz of the matzah. Like Rashi himself, that Mimbab Bal Nav says, Mufurish. In the etz of the matzah, there's no din. And when someone's wearing the iser, it's not the Shabbos, he just didn't listen to Hashem. He didn't listen to Hashem through the Shabbos. What we call a cheftz of the yisur, a cheftz of the mitzvah. And the point is, of a mitzvah is it's not something that a timsa. Rather, it's a bria. It's an organism. It's a chetza. It's an idea farzach. And when a person does an atilas lulav, what he's really doing is an atilas lulav. When he's doing an achilas matzv, he's doing an achilas matzv. Which means that everything isn't just. And the Shachaim says this mafurish, homiletically. But it's not just a chetimsa for you to do a mitzvah. It's chal, it's an etzem chetz. And therefore, since it lives, and a mitzvah lives, One of my students called me after Pesach this year. He said, when I was eating the matzah, I was eating the matzah. And I said, when you were listening to Shiur, you were listening to Shiur. But that's the truth, because that's the whole point. Mela, if we go back to our machlekes, the Rambam, and where the Rambam argued and said he can't understand it to be an official, an artificial year, it's obvious what the Rambam held. So the Rambam of Art, when a person does a mitzvah, it's not just hechitimson. Something that lives. Something that's chal on Yud Dalut Pesach, that has to be that there's a chetz of a Korban Pesach. Not that you ate the Korban Pesach. There was a kiyum din of Korban Pesach. And the yoyim of Yud Dalut Pesach is mechayivt. And then something that happens to be, when we celebrate January 1st, there's nothing chal on the yoyim. Even Macy's. It's not chal on the yoyim. It's just a hechetimsa to celebrate. By us, it's not like that. There's something about the day of Yud Dalet Adar in Yerushalayim and Tetzvav Adar here that shtel zois a kriyas megillah. Mela, the Rambam had to get up there and say there's a real year. Because it would be an artificial year, the Rambam said, you can't do mitzvahs in an artificial time. Chaya, that should be the vort, something simple. I'd just like to say something before Rabbi Rand comes. I was warned during the Levaya. I was warned by someone. And I didn't listen to him. And during Shiva, I got the same warning. And again, I didn't listen. And during Shloshim, the third time, I didn't listen. They told me, and betcha I paid a difficult price. They told me, Meir, if it's not a Shver Shana, it's gonna be a hard year. Brace yourself for it. And I didn't. And by not acting upon their advice, I had it very Shver. I would go through my father's Svarim, and I was blown away with the amount he knew. His footnotes on the bottom. His footnotes before the invention of a computer. Or beyond, or beyond. His bekiyas on Svarim that none of us heard of. None of us have heard his Svarim. I went around yeshiva. I took a chavrusa and we learned my father's Svarim. And I would go around, did you ever hear of the Sefer? Never. Well, it's hard. You know, it was a pamphlet, Chaymer Islamid, printed, you know, before the war, you know, in Prague. Impossible. Unheard of. The Bekiyas was unparalleled. And during the year, I would cry. It was impossible. I missed the geschmack, the quick humor, his Simchas Achaim. I also missed terribly his stories. We speak about the old yeshiva, the old Chicago. They had that right. And we speak about the Toldos Gedolei Yerushalayim. We lived in a bubble in our house. We lived in it was a time machine. I push it. I embraced myself and I paid a price for it. So it is impossible to sum up one's life in a few minutes. I don't want to leave you, those who knew him, maybe some of the Talmidim, with a message. There's a Ramban in this week's Parsha, above us the Ramban. And the Ramban asked the Kash, he says, why doesn't God do Nisim every day? Why is there only Nisim Galui Yitzias Mitzrayim? Says the Ramban, because the Rabbi Shalom made a world of Teva. We live a natural world. And the world has laws. And the Rabbi Shalom is not out to change them. Nor of us. What he did was, in Yitzias Mitzrayim, he made Neis Geluyim. And therefore he made us Mechuyiv to recall, to relive it, to reestablish the Nisim. And the idea isn't that they went out 2,000 years ago. This is the Yisrael of the Ramban. Something for every bacher to know. What he did was, by recalling it, by reliving it, by reestablishing it, We went out of Yetzias Mitzrayim. When I see Yetzias Mitzrayim, I see nothing now. Chayav Adam Liris Af Gilu Hu Yotza Hayoyim in Mitzrayim. Chayav Adam Liris Kilu Hayoyim. Kibbol Toyim Zinah. The Nisim, when we put on tefillin, is that we're reliving Mitzrayim. We need to go out there, we're not today. Napoleon once said about the Jews, they cry about the temple 2,000 years ago. When Napoleon lost in this part of Waterloo, was, no, we didn't go out then, we went out today. The temple didn't burn yesterday, didn't burn then, it burned today. And if a person can live with ideas of the Torah, you can live in a different idea. And you can live in yesterday. My father was a gadol of Yesteryur. And with him, the feeling of the yeshiva to me has gone down. And with him, the old Chicago stepped to the down. And with him, the feelings of Yerushalayim and Yidin, Emistik and Yidin, has somewhat diminished. However, we take one message from my father, and apply it, then we can actually relive it. And we can burn that fire, yana fire of Yerushalayim. And we can relive that fire. I'm just going to say over something which I think encapsulates my father. There's a story in Navi and Malachim Beis. Mrs. Langster, if you could tell my mother I said something about Navi, I'd appreciate it. Okay? The Shunamis was a woman. Who would help out Elisha? She built a loft for him. And Elisha turned to Gehazi and he asked Gehazi, what should we do for this woman? So they called the lady. Vayhi hayoim. Vayoim rala. Hine charat alin was kol acharado hazois. Man lasois lach. Hayesh duchol ledaber la melech yisar tzavos. What can I do for you? Elisha asked the Shunamis, what can I do for you? Do you need me to speak to the king or to the Tsar Tzava? It's like the Zoyar. It wasn't a regular day. Vayhi Hayoyim was Rosh Hashanah. And Elisha asked the Shunamis, would you like me to speak to the king? Yisar Tzava means you want me to speak to the Malachim. Anything I can do, I will help you. It's Rosh Hashanah. And the Shunami answered 5 words. Vayoyim Batreimer. Besoch Ami, Ani Yoshevet. A lady who was childless, who needed everything, says 1-5 words. The Gadol Adar says, I will do anything for you. She is waiting for her life for this moment. Your answer is, Besoch Ami, Ani Yoshevet. This word encapsulates my father. The pasuk says, "A yisal chacham b'chachmasa." A person who has a chacham should not be a bal gaiva. A person who's an yasher shouldn't have arrogance. The reason why a chacham could be a bal gaiva, there's a reason for him. He has something that no one else has. A wealthy person has something that nobody else has. Others don't. And the Torah says, no, but be smarter. My father was a chacham she'ein alav kechachmas. The key is, we have one idea that no one else had. B'soch ami ani yoshevet. Should say no one, chas v'shem. But this was his idea. His warmth, his goodness, his humbleness, and his love for a fellow Jew was from this vart. B'soch ami. I'm one of the boys. I have no doubt that today's football game was canceled, or it's 4:30 today. Larry was telling me. Because he wouldn't want to shlut anybody. B'soch ami ani yoshevet. That was my fault. B'soch ami. And I sat by the Levaya a typical day when he went to Yerushalayim, he would go out to Yogi Rimmel's house in the Beit Suf, in the Shtachid. He would daven mincha by the Svardim Musayif. And then at night, he would go to English Shahaisa to speak to the Yerushalayim Eidin. But my father had a musig, don't be baitik at Sveitis Tzitzis. It's not worth it. Why would you? If I can't, don't look at somebody else. You gain nothing. It's not smart. It just shows some arrogance. This is the way how he lived. It's the way he died. And this is the way we should remember him. And like the Rambam's of art, that a person taking a nace of yesteryear isn't just yesterday, it's not from yesterday. We don't live Yiddishkeit 2,000 years ago. We live in Hayoim, Chayim Adam Lira, Hayoim Kibalti Torah, Hayoim. Chayim Adam Lira says, As we do Atta Yoitzim Tzrayim. Men left us, yes! We live in now. We live in now. And if you take an idea of someone, you can live it now. So personally, I lost this idea of what godless was from yesteryear. And maybe you lost part of it, what the yeshiva was, and what it should be. Obviously still a wonderful makom tov. We could bring down, bring back the godless that they brought from Europe. And we can live it, not we could think what was. We can live it. My father's message in life was, yes, you have to be a Talmud Chacham. And there's nothing less. And I'm arts. My father, it wasn't, everything was not right to learn and learn. But the B'seich Ami Ani Yashavis. It's not a mensch. B'seich Ami Ani Yashavis. I thank you all for coming today. My older brother. And my father's chus. Just saw my good friend walked in.
Thank you so much, Rav Meir, for these beautiful words in the Divrei Torah. Rav Meir also lives this idea of because he only let me introduce him as a Rosh Hashiva for a cover of his father. That's literally why he let me even say that. Our next speaker, Tzion Rand, is very close with Rav Sender Zatzal for 45 years now, in so many different capacities as a Talmud of the Yeshiva, as a close colleague, as a congregant. So it's a chus gadol for us to hear Divrei Zikar from Rabbi Rand.
Disclaimer for the Talmidim, the younger Talmidim who are here, who were barely youngsters, toddlers, when Rabbi Sender even left the yeshiva. And I imagine for them, they're wondering what they're doing here and what this means to them. But to a certain extent, I think it means more to them, it should mean more to them, than almost to the rest of us, because it's a link. It's a link, and it shows you that we're standing on shoulders. Your Rebbeim, Heb Rebbeim, and the greater Rebbeim, and this is a link to Sinai, nothing less. And it's important to see that, to hear that, to be part of it. So even though it's in your mind, it's an imagination, and you're hearing words, but it does represent real people that really existed and sat in these halls and taught Torah and continued the Masorah. I want to also make one other disclaimer. Those who know me know I rarely speak from a text. I don't think it's comfortable to listen to when someone's looking at a paper just reading from it personally. And also I like to be just a little bit more natural with my ideas. But I also know myself when I get very emotional that I lose out on specifics and details which I don't want to lose. I probably wouldn't get too much off track, but I certainly would lose things, would not be the covered of a Rebbe. So I'm going to be looking at the text a little more than I'm used to, so I apologize for that. To a certain extent, I feel like a child standing at the foot of the Hancock Center and looking straight up, perhaps with blinding sun over the tip of the top, and trying to estimate its height. How can I evaluate Rabbi Sender, my Rebbe? Such a masmi, he possessed such great midos, he was with Marbitz Torah, and he shaped the lives of countless men and women. Yet we have an obligation to identify the loss and capture the lessons we could gain. The Gemara tells us we are not allowed to be misatzel with the Hesped of a gadol. We cannot be lazy, we cannot be lax, so we have to do our best to properly eulogize. This is our duty. This is now the first Yahrzeit of our esteemed Rebbe. I also heard from Malachim, also from Elisha. When Eliyahu HaNavi departed from him and rise to the heavens, Elisha called out, Avi, Avi, Rechev Yisrael, who parasha, you are my father, and you're the chariot and the horseman of the Jewish people. The term Avi refers to that Eliyahu was a master or teacher of Eliyahu, because a true Torah teacher considers himself, the father and the students, to be like his own children. The description of Eliyahu to be a chariot or horseman refers to the fact that due to his power of tefillah, Eliyahu was the defender and protector of the Jewish people. He provided them with security, and that's what's afforded by soldiers and warriors. It also refers to the koach of Torah, which also protects. These terms therefore apply to Rabbi Sender. He was our father figure, and he was a master of tefillah, and he was a Marbitz Torah. Avi, Avi. He was our father in so many ways. The world of chinuch today is not what it was 60 years ago. Rabbi Sender entered the world of learning and teaching Torah during an era where it was not held in high esteem. He developed a love for Torah and a profound respect for Talmidei Chachamim in an environment where he had almost no peer group, which showed him that path to emes. He admired and studied the lives of the Gedolim with a passion and with a love, and he was only at ease when he was part of that world of these giants, both the contemporary as well as of the past. His home was lined with pictures of Gedolim, and these pictures decorated the walls of the sukkah as well. He considered these personalities to be his heroes. In fact, the last time my wife and I visited the Senders in Lakewood, Rabbi Sender's eyesight was already failing him. He presented me with a booklet of short biographies of Gedolei Yerushalayim. See, it's a Chelek Dalet, he probably had a short series of these. He had just published it. He must have dictated the entire thing to one of his grandchildren to have it printed. He was still thriving in that world. His mind was walking the streets of Yerushalayim. He was visiting the personalities he still adored. He was such a pillar of Torah. His Mesorah was our Rechev, Yisrael, Parasha, and we miss him. He loved Sfarim. He would visit bookstores and was touched with Rabbi Sfarim around the world. He was our consultant for the Yotzar Sfarim, Rabbi Achazan Shul, and in the yeshiva. He knew the stacks of the yeshiva's library by heart. Rabbi Freeman told me he was also in Lakewood visiting with Rabbi Sender. Rabbi Sender wanted a particular text, a volume we had, and he instructed him exactly which shelf and which book and how to find it, and that's where the book was found. He knew what the collection contained, and he knew the articles, and many of the Torah periodicals which it subscribed. Often when he bought a sefer for himself, he also found an appropriate sefer for his wife, and he would bring it home for her to enjoy. He didn't just love Sfarim, he loved people. He loved his fellow Jew, and he admired everyone for who they were. He was so content with life, such a feel-good approach towards chinuch and teaching youth and adult alike, The commitment he and his Rebbetzin made to serve Klal Yisrael was monumental, and it met with tremendous siyata d'shmaya. It was no doubt a challenge, but the difficulties they faced seemed to contribute to the impact they made on decades of Talmidim and their families. I am aware firsthand of Talmidim, young men in the community, who were often invited to the Shabbos and Yom Tov table of the senders. It could truly be said, "Zeh Shulchan Asher Lifnei Hashem." It was not only filled with Torah, but with goodness of life and pleasantness of what an ideal Torah family should be. The senders merited the blessing of many sons, who have grown to be leaders of men, each unique, but united in following the path of outstanding Torah leadership of Rabbi Zusa Torah. He was the father of a royal legion of sons, and he extended his family to include the young men of the community. Avi, we lament, but we have lost our father. He was a remarkable masmid. He developed a close connection to outstanding European Rabbani who had escaped Europe and found a way to join the staff at the yeshiva in Chicago. His rebbeim include Rabbi Chaim Regensburg, Rabbi David Kaganov, Rabbi Chaim Kreisworth, Rabbi Mordechai Rogov, and Rabbi Chaim Zimmerman. Rebbe absorbed the Torah and entered into their world. He was able to nurture from the rich foundation and build from it throughout his life. He had a close kesher with Rav Shlomo Zalman Orbach, and they kept in contact over the years. His very being radiated with Torah values and the simchas achayim and the satisfaction it affords. He was a noted speaker. He was invited to address gatherings of many organizations and moses of the city. He had the special ability to entertain, the light remark, capture the attention and imagination of a group of even the most advanced students and groups with his stories, mishalim, and powerful images of Musar HaShkafa. Rechav Yisrael Parashav, we are now missing this giant in Torah teaching. Rabbi Avraham Friedman, Shlita, Rosh Yeshiva, told me that when the Beis Yaakov Day School wanted to ask him and his wife to be honored at their banquet, and those of you who know that committee that goes to the honorees' house to try to convince them, it's not an easy task. And the girls of the JDBY, they sent Rabbi Sender to ask them to accept the honor. They knew that the Freedmans had the utmost respect for Rabbi Sender and they would not be able to refuse his request. It worked. Rabbi Sender and his Rebbe sent Davin with us for the Yom Noroim at the yeshiva here in Skokie. We were zochah to observe Rabbi Sender became immersed in a lengthy Shmon Esrei in the intensity of his tefillos. Often as we finished Maariv and the Talmidim would file by to say Yom Tov Rebbein, Rabbi Sender was still under his talis, bent over and shuffling intensely as we filed by and just were able to glance at his back. Anyone who observed that would be changed forever. And now, in many ways, watching Rebbetzin Sender, Shetitia, when she would bench lift for the Yom Noroim, it was even more moving than to me than even the Ela. As many men were not home when our wives light Shabbos candles. Here, on our way to Dav Mincha, to come to the Beis Medrash, we captured a rare glimpse of the candle lighting taking place in the lunchroom. The intensity of her Yehi Ratzon, her cries and her sobs clearly shook the heavens, and her tefillos were accepted. This may be the secret to the successes of Rabbi Sender. Sender's both taught us how to be parents to our children and to our students. Avi, this is why we not cry out. Every year, Rabbi Sender would deliver the drasha before Ne'ilah. He would speak softly, but it was powerful. His message was this was our last chance to be zocheh in the din. He said the coming year would come, and all that would occur was now in our hands at that moment. The moment might later come, he said. We would think back and say, oh, if only we would have been better at Ne'ilah, perhaps things could have been better now. This, therefore, as Nehila was about to begin, was his message of hope and encouragement to use the passing opportunity to his utmost. He was a world-class author, a mechaber of many chashuv svarim on many topics. The themes he wrote were unusual, covered topics not usually covered, studied in classic yeshivas. I remember Meir Schlesinger, Shlita, formerly Rosh Yeshiva of Yeshivas Shalavim. He always sent back regards to me, back to Chicago, to Rabbi Center. He said, ask him if he's published any new svarim. His svarim are so delicious, they got the best topics. Find out if he has another sefer for me. The topics were Kiddush HaChodesh, Tefillah, Sanhedrin, Tanakh, and Nevuah. Till this day, they're the world standard in their class. His series on the commentators Haggadah are well in demand through the English-speaking world. They cover topics, his other svarim cover topics for davening for weekdays and Shabbos, for Yom Yerushalayim. He has volumes on Hallel, Hanukkah, and Purim, Shabbos Day. He has a separate volume on the giving of the Torah. Selections of some of these were subsequently sent out in booklet form by some institutions for the Yom Yerushalayim. Thousands of pages, insights, stories, and developed concepts, rich in content and deep in substance. He didn't have somebody write these for him. They were a written record of his Torah perspective on life. Recha Yisrael Parasha, he was a world-class educator. We are alone without him. My parents brought me into this world, and they understood very well the meaning of a Jewish education. My father, Zichrono Livracha, as well, my mother, Shetichya, they did everything in their power to send my sisters and myself to the best mostos and yeshivas possible. Rabbi Sender did the rest. Together with the wonderful staff of Rabbein, who took the Talmidim under their wings and directed us throughout our lives. Our Rabbein took us under their wings and directed us throughout our lives. From the moment I had the swiss day of Rabbi Sender in my 11th grade, he became my Rebbe for life. I vividly remember many aspects of the year that I was in a shiur and the transition I experienced with my new Ruchnius father. I remember Rabbi Sender standing behind us, often with his arm around our shoulders, always with a loving smile. There were personal encounters I had with him. I asked him about kashrus issues. At that time, standards of kashrus and the agencies were not as sophisticated. And believe it or not, people used to suffice by looking at the ingredients to see if there was any glycerin or whatever. And people, that was the standard. Rabbi Shanilov, congrats to you for what you've done. But I remember bringing a package of salad dressing, some powder that you mix with, and I showed it to him. I said, is this okay? He got so upset with me. He said, do never put anything in your mouth that doesn't have a hechsher on it. That was not so common in those days, but that made a very strong impact upon me. I remember talking about some interest I had in sports at that time. He spoke to me in firm fatherly terms, made an impact on me, and which began to direct me in the direction of Ahava Yiras Shamayim. I remember one summer, I came back from Chicago after learning in Eretz Yisrael. I wanted to find a chabrusa in the city. I don't know exactly how it came about, but I know that the next thing that I knew, I had the schools to learn Rabbi Sender every morning that summer. We sat in Beis Yitzchak, and as we went through a good portion of one of the svarim he had just published. Imagine that, I established Rabbi the Yeshiva. Those years was willing to learn with a teenage bachur during the summer on a daily basis. It must have been some element of Mesiras Nefesh to agree to give up some of his precious time, but he realized that this young boy needed the chizuk. Avi, when he was still here, I had my father and Ruchnius with me, but now I cry out without him. I consider him my spiritual father. He was my guiding light in every aspect of life. When the time came, he was active and directed me in the area of Shidduchim. He monitored and shaped my career in Chinuch. I was offered to be a serve as a Rebbe together with him in Yeshiva for many years. I raised my family under his supervision. Our family davened with the senders for many years, together with Zidish Rebbe Rebbe, Mehev Rufur Shlemo, the Rebbe Achazet Beis Medrash, now known as the Center for Torah and Chesed. My sons were impressed. I spoke to them before coming today, and they told me they remember, and they're impressed by the fact that I should take the Rebbe Center to take a Shabbos every week. He gave Shabbos afternoon daf shir for many years. I would occasionally sub for him for that shir, and I saw the many loyal men who would attend, some walking pretty far to participate in the shir. I could still see how he walked home every Shabbos with Sheldon Robinson Alav HaShalom, his brother Jerome Alav HaShalom, and Yibar Lachayim Rabbi Liebenstein Shlita. I remember watching this precious team of leaders in Klal Yisrael as they shared and shmoozed. They enriched each other's lives in so many ways. Rabbi Sender was a tzaddik for one of my sons. He was present at our family's machos. He was my mentor and role model in publishing the few Sfarim I produced under his tutelage. He was a professional author and publisher. And as such, he was willing to share with me his experience in fundraising, writing, editing, design, and marketing. I've heard one of my former Talmidim to him, who he hired to design one of his own Sfarim, and one of my daughters typeset and assisted in editing another. He introduced me to the people at Feldheim who accepted to publish the Sefer I was working on. I'm sure it was due to Rabbi Sender's connection that they agreed. Rabbi Sender once noticed I looked very disappointed. He asked me, "What's bothering you?" I told him I had just spoken with a particular Rosh Yeshiva from the East to ask for Haskama for a Sefer I was working on. And this Rosh Yeshiva refused me. He said, as a rule, he wasn't in favor of translation of English Sfarim. Rabbi Sender almost fell over. He looked at me and said, "What? Why didn't you ask me before calling him? I could have told you. He has a European background and he is opposed to English Sfarim for B'nai Torah. Next time I'll tell you who to call. Who to call to ask for Haskamos." We were once at a chasana together. They had a daughter of one of the Rebbeim in the yeshiva. My wife and I were to be making a simcha that week. In any case, the chuppah was held outdoors. It was pouring rain. The only people who went outdoors were the family and the direct participants in the chuppah. Everyone else stood inside, watching behind the doors of the simcha hall. Rabbi Sender was given an honor. And later, I was called out to also for one of the brachos under the chuppah. But by the time I went outside, there was no more room under the chuppah for anyone to stand. So I stood nearby near the edge of the chuppah, getting soaked. Suddenly, his arm sticks out of the chuppah. Rabbi Sender's arm stuck out of the chuppah. He grabbed me, and he pulled me back under the chuppah. He looked at me and said, "You're making a bar mitzvah this week. You can't catch a cold." That's how a father reacts. Avi, Avi, Rochei Yisrael Parashok. Rabbi Sender Zatzal is sorely missed, but his Torah and his powerful impact continue to inspire and guide us in our lives. May he continue to be a Melech Tzion for his family and for Klal Yisrael. Yehi Zichro Baruch.
Thank you, Rabbi Rand, for those very meaningful, emotional remarks. Final speaker we have Rabbi Avi Goldfeder, a very close Talmud of Rabbi Sender, and has told me many times Rabbi Sender really transformed his life through the relationship he had, very similar to the words we heard from Rabbi Rand. It was Rabbi Avi who was instrumental in starting the Rabbi Sender Zatzal Memorial Eon Library, which is being built. You can see the sign outside in the, thankfully for the family, the Friedman family, Cheder Ian, one of the nicest rooms we have on this campus, down the hall, where there's a section that's being put aside for this special library in memory of Rabbi Sender. It was Rabbi Avi who was the one who initiated it, and was the driving force behind that. So we have a lot of karas hatov to Rabbi Avi for that. It's a kavod gadol to have Rabbi Avi say a few words here.
Thank you, Rabbi Shulman. Quite frankly, I never thought I'd be standing at this particular place, even though I spent many years on this campus. I didn't think I'd ever have the schus to stand in front of the Beis Medrash to talk about any particular subject, let alone the feelings of a Kar Satov to a Rebbe Zatzal. When Rabbi Schumann asked me if I wanted to participate and speak, quite frankly, I was a little surprised, I was a little astonished. After all, I wasn't a Talmud Muvak, I didn't have smicha from a Rav Sender Zatzal, and then it dawned upon me that the reason why Rabbi Schumann really wanted me to speak was he was convinced that if I did accept to speak, and as much as Rabbi Sender's in Gan Eden busy continuing his ksavim and writing more commentator svarim, once he saw the posters that Goldfeder was speaking, he would be for sure listening. They got Goldfeder to speak? Oh, this I gotta hear. Shusha Rosh Hashiva, Rabbi Schumann, Shusha Rameir Sender, Rav Shlomi Sender, Shusha Rabbi Alstein, the Talmidim of the Yeshiva, Anhala of the Yeshiva, and please allow me a brief second to also ask Rishus and to express my Hakara Satov to Harab Binyamin Shandaloff, who continues to have a tremendous influence in my life and taught me and continues to teach me so much. It was very difficult to come up with what to speak about this morning. Dalet Shvat happens to be the Yahrzeit of my mother, Allah Shalom. Yesterday, as I daven Musaf for the Amid, which included Rosh Chodesh benching, and as I was mispalel for a mazel dik achaydesh, it dawned upon me what I wanted to say this morning. Parshas Bo, this week's parsha, the mitzvah of sanctifying a new moon, is given to Bnei Yisrael. The question is asked, why was the mitzvah given more than 2 months before Matan Torah? And why is it so important that this was the first mitzvah that Bnei Yisrael got as a nation, even before the Aseres Adibros? We know that the sanctification of a new moon, of a Levana, represents the idea of rejuvenation. By placing the Jewish calendar under the cycle of the moon, the Rabbanu Shlom was instructing us that our time frame is cyclic in nature. And just as the moon renews itself every single month, so we too as a people have to continue to concentrate and have the power to revitalize ourselves. As we know, the Hebrew name for Kodesh in itself is the word new, chadash, newness, which with each month, a spiritual renewal comes to this world, and we are given a chance to start anew. Why was the mitzvah given more than 2 months before Matan Torah? Why was it the first mitzvah that the Rabbanu Shalom gave to us, a nation? Because it is a critical, what Bnei Yisrael was going through at the time, was a critical junction between slavery and redemption. And Hashem wanted his children to have the hiskadish, a freshness, and therefore to begin anew as they became a nation. Hashem wanted us to have a muna in a brighter future. My dear friends, that was our beloved and my beloved Rebbe, Rav Yitzchak Isaac Sender Zatzal. Whether a Talmud, a balabas, or just a worker, a janitor in the yeshiva, Rabbi Sender approached every single day with a freshness, a newness, a chance to come up with a chiddush and a new gemara, an opportunity finally to get through to a difficult bachur, a new chance to overcome a particular shiloh that he had. Every day, every single day, a freshness, a new approach to Yiddishkeit. Rabbi Sender wasn't a Rebbe's Rebbe. He was a Talmud's Rebbe. Let me try to explain. I heard Shiur for the first time from Rabbi Sender in my senior year in high school. Masechta was Sanhedrin. And for those of the older people here this morning, they can relate that as a senior in high school, our first concern was not Shiur. We had finally made it. Seniors, we were in charge. Gorm Spiel, yearbook, hockey, baseball, gym. I was in charge of the infirmary that year. So many responsibilities. And yet, you still had to go to Shiur, or so it seemed. We'd walk into Shiur, Rabbi Sender would begin giving Shiur, and after a few minutes or so, our minds would begin to drift off. And that was usually myself. I can only talk about myself. I'm not Chas V'Shalom going to talk about any of the other young men that were in my Shiur that year. When Rebbe would notice that we were drifting, he had a tendency of getting up from his chair and walking up and down the aisles. I'm not going to say he only stopped by me, but it seemed like he always only stopped by me. And you'd get that little zug, and you were brought back into reality. And then he would bend down and whisper in your ear, where no one else could hear except you, "The Sox won last night." That question, the first time I heard it, woke me up beyond belief. My Rebbe just asked me if the Sox won last night. And when I answered yes, it was followed with that whisper in my ear, "Who pitched?" And if I knew the answer, he would move on. And trust me, I stayed up the rest of that year. Because it showed me that my Rebbe, who was trying to teach me something other than the importance of who won the Sox game the other night, had a human touch and understood sometimes where we were coming from. He was a Talmud's Rebbe. He was concerned about each and every Talmud, to make them better in any way possible. The year was also 1977. Rebbe had one rule. You had to be in Shiur by 9:15. That's when Shiur started. If you were not in Shiur by 9:15, the door closed, locked, and there could be consequences. And my life, my senior year here, was nothing but consequences. Subsequently, it was on a Sunday morning, it was Zos Chanukah. I had been in Minyan, and I quickly left after laning to grab a cup of coffee in the kitchen. And I had figured I'd be able to get at least 45 to 50 minutes of a nap before I had to get to Shiur. I reminded my roommate to please wake me up by 9:05 at the very latest, and I went upstairs to my dorm room. The next thing I knew, I looked, I opened my eye, and those famous digital clocks, the 10, clicked over to 9:11, 4 minutes to get to Shiur. I was already on a little thin ice. I quickly jumped out of bed, made my way through the middle staircase, came running through the cafeteria, the dining room, and as I had done thousands of times before, went through the first two doors, lifted my knee to push the push bar, to get through the next two doors, And somehow I must have been running too quickly, and instead of my knee hitting the push bar, my body went through the window. Yes, I was injured, and injured seriously. And as my left arm hung by barely a string, and as Rabbi Shaneloff attended to me and waited for the ambulance, I said, "Oy, what's going to happen? I'm going to get in trouble from being late to shiur." The next morning, as I got up to have Kohen to bench Goymel, after 3.5 hour operation and more than 500 stitches, as a friend of mine helped me take my tefillin off, he whispered in my ear, "Avi, your father's here." Sure enough, I turned around and my father was standing in the Ezra's Noshim, as he had come up to check to make sure I was really okay, even though Rabbi Shaneloff had probably spent 6 hours on the phone calming my mother down. I quickly greeted my father. Certain members of the Hanhala went to greet my father, and I kept looking to make sure Rabbi Sender wasn't going up to talk to my father. That's not what I needed. And as I prepared to walk with my father to the dorm to get some breakfast, all of a sudden, there he was. Standing next to me and my father was my Rebbe, Rabbi Sender. Inasmuch as they had spoken before, I introduced Rabbi Sender to my father, and lo and behold, I'm not going to say I got a glowing report, but the knowledge that Rabbi Sender knew that I was going home for 2 weeks of therapy and to continue to recuperate, he sent me off with my father with an unbelievable report that I was doing well, not only in shiur but in the year, thus providing me 2 weeks of menuchas nefesh as I stayed home for those 2 weeks with my parents. As we walked from here to the dining hall, Rabbi Sender turned to me at one point and said, "Avi," I turned around, and at that point, Rabosa, I would have done anything for Rebbe. He gave me, this was great. I said, "Yes, Rebbe." He says, "Do me a favor." I said, "What, Rebbe?" He said, "When you get back for the rest of the year, you can come 5 minutes late to shiur." That was Rabbi Sender. That was a Rebbe. He always tried to teach us lessons in every single way. In Beis Medrash, I got very confused. For certain months out of every year, Rabbi Sender would leave after Minucha through these doors, go to his car, and move on to his next job, which was at TI. And yet during certain months, I'd walk with him through this door, down to this middle where he'd make the left and go to the parking lot. A tad confusing. Does it have something to do with the weather? What was going on? Because Rabbi Sender always had reasons. Finally, I went up to him. I said, "Rebbe, can I ask you a question?" "What?" I said, "Why is it that certain times after Minucha you go out this door to your car, and other times you walk this way, and then you make the left and take your car from the parking lot?" He smiled at me, and he said, "You're observant, Goldfeder. You should be that observant and shiur." I said, "No, come on, Rebbe, what's the reason?" He gave me an unbelievable lesson in Yetzirah. What was the reason? Come on. During Elul and a bit of Tishrei, and after Pesach, he would go this way. Because at 1:15, 1:30, 1:45, what was going on? There was a baseball game going on. During the winter months, when it was too cold, he'd go that way. I said, "Rebbe, what? I don't get it." He said, "Yetzirah. By the mere fact that I can walk this way and get a little stickle of an epis a schmeck of a good baseball game going on. A good pitch, a good hit, a good play on the field is enough to satisfy my Yetzer Hara. I said, Rebbe, that's enough to satisfy your Yetzer Hara. Why don't you take off your jacket, loosen your tie, and you'll come, you'll sit, you'll play with us. I got to prepare this year, got to do this, got to do that. You have to know, Avi, when and how to satisfy and move that Yetzer Hara away and fight it, only to do the Ratzon of the Rabbeinu Shalom. That was an unbelievable lesson that I still remember to this day. He tried teaching us things by stories. One of the best stories he told was about the four old ladies that were driving in a car. They were definitely older. And finally, after driving about 10 minutes, the driver realized that there was a policeman behind the car. She pulled over. The policeman comes to the car and says, "Ma'am, is everything okay?" She says, "Yes, officer. Did I do anything wrong?" He says, "No, but do you know what the speed limit is?" And she said, "Yes, 22. And he said, "No, ma'am, the speed limit's not 22. You are on Route 22. You're going 22 miles an hour. That's why I stopped you, because you're going so slow." "Oh, I'm sorry, officer. I'll try to do better." He looked in the back seat, and there were three women sitting in the back, white as a ghost. He looked at them with a concern, and he said, "Ladies, are you okay? You seem to be very, very, very perturbed or uneasy." Whereupon one of the women explained to the officer and said, "Mr. Policeman, we just got off Route 110. Rebbe would always tell us, "Are we reading our signs correctly? Our very lives may depend on different signs that we're getting from the Rabbeinu Shalom. Pay attention," he would say. And we tried every single day to do the Ratzon of our Rav Sender Zatzal, to pay attention to the lessons that he tried desperately to put into us. As I said, he was a Talmud's Rebbe, always willing to go to bat, always willing to help us out. Let me conclude with the winter of 1979. About this time of the year, it started snowing Thursday afternoon. It didn't stop until Sunday morning. 29 inches, 35 inches, 40 inches. The city of Chicago was shut down. I was head counselor at the time, and it wasn't easy. There wasn't a Rebbe in the building. And with him present, I could easily say, Rabbi Shanloff was calling me every 2 to 3 seconds. "Is everything okay? How are we doing? What's going on?" It was a little nuts. We were trying to keep the bathroom busy, and quite frankly, by Sunday morning at 10:30, we were worried about what we were going to be serving for lunch and dinner Sunday night. Nothing was moving. Even Dr. Babad Zatzal couldn't make it down from his house through the alley down to the yeshiva because the snow was so high. It was about 10:30, I was in the kitchen, and all of a sudden I heard clapping coming out of the dining room. "What's going on?" I quickly came out of what we call Mr. Stone's office. I made my way into the dining room, and I heard that ever so familiar shuffle. It was Rabbi Sender. Gray coat with the black collar, his hat, those fireman galosh boots that he used to wear in the winter, I went running up to him as I instructed another bucher to get a cup of coffee. Rabbi, I said, Rabbi Sender, what are you doing here? How'd you get here? He responded that it took him almost 3 hours. Rabbi ran, and I'm not mistaken, I think you were in the car. I'm not mistaken. It took him almost 3 hours to get here from West Rogers Park. I said, what'd you come for? I gotta give shiur. That's a dedicated Rebbe. And then he whispered to me, he says, Goldfeder, grab some buckram and go to my car. We put on our coats. We went outside to the parking lot, which resembled a I don't know what, I don't even know how we pulled in. And we opened up his trunk. And in his trunk had to be about 50, 55 bags. You see, what Rabbi Sender had done was before he made his way to the yeshiva, he had stopped at Tel Aviv Bakery. He knew Bakram had to eat. Danishes, brownies, donuts, bagels, bread, challah.
We had nothing left.
That was Rabbi Sender. Ruchnius and Gashmius. He always wanted to make sure that the Talmud came first. As we unloaded his car, and there was a definite joy that we were going to have something stable, and there was even brownies, I remember he brought a box of brownies. That story will remain with me forever, because that's an unbelievable lesson that I learned, that a Rebbe will always be concerned about the entire Talmud, the entire Bacher. I want to thank Rabbi Schumann and the yeshiva, the entire Hanhala, for not only allowing me to share these thoughts, but for having this Yom HaZikaron, Lezecher Nishmas, HaRav Sender Zatzal. I would also like to thank Dr. and Mrs. Michael Freeman and Mr. and Mrs. David Freeman and their families for allowing the Rabbi Isaac Sender Memorial Library to be placed in their classroom that they had donated in memory of their parents. It is my wish, it is my tefillah, that the lessons that I learned and so many more Talmidim and Balabatim learned from our Yitzchak Isaac Sender Zatzal should stay with us. He should continue to be a Melech Yashar for his entire mishpacha. Allow me, please, publicly to give to his Rebbetzin not only a bracha of Arichas Yomim, but a mazel tov, as she recently celebrated the birth of her first Goreinikel, a baby boy born to Rav Meir and Rebbetzin Sender, and yes, his name is Yitzchak Isaac. May she continue to have Arichas Yomim. May she be benched with nachas from her children, her Einikluch and her Ur Einikluch. And may we all be zeicha to take the lessons that all of us learned from Rabbi Sender and keep them as part of our life, day in and day out. Abiyas Agoam Mashiach Imheru V'Yameinu.
Amen.
Thank you, Rabbi. We're going to dive in Mincha right now. I encourage everyone to take a look at the Friedman family, Henry, and to see the library that's being put in place in memory of Rabbi Sender.